Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, welcome back. This is the fifth lecture of the fourth week of the material science of rechargeable batteries. Today I'm going to summarize the fourth week. Okay, what did we learn this week? First, we introduced some elements of reaction theory. Okay, where we said that in one side of the electrode and the other side of the electrolyte, there's an energy barrier that we would have to overcome in order to inject lithium into the material, or say to plate it. In other words, there's some energy barrier that has to be overcome. And if you do that, if you account for that energy barrier, you have to then introduce contributions for forward and backward reaction rate at equilibrium. These two balance each other so that you have some kinetic equilibrium where the rate of the forward reaction is balanced by the backward of reaction. Okay, mathematically, that is specified by introducing the concept of a total current in the system, basically the difference between the forward and backward current, where if we apply an overpotential, one would expect that the bottom of one of these wells will become more stable. If you do that, what you will find is that the forward current is proportional to the amount of a reactant on the unreacted side, and minus the amount of vacancies that are available. If there are no vacancies available, basically nothing will come in the opposite direction. Okay, and if we assume that the reaction is of Arrhenius type, then you have that the forward reaction rate constant is proportional to the driving force, in this case the Gibbs free energy of formation, driving the system, in this case how this energy barrier changes as I apply an overpotential to the system. We can write that forward and backward reaction free energy driving forces in terms of what the total overpotential of the system is. They think of it as the electrochemical potential of the system, okay, proportion and multiplied by this scalar value that gives me a measure of the strength of that driving force, and the same, of course, in the backward direction. This effective overpotential, if you may, is proportional to the electrical interfacial overpotential and the chemical potential difference between what occurs in the electrode side and in the electrolyte side. If you include all of these, what you will find is that this reaction rate is really proportional to the local applied overpotential in the system. Okay, so if my overpotential is positive, I will favor a material in one direction, because the exponential of a very large negative number will become effectively zero. And if instead I apply a negative overpotential, this term will shut down and the other one will turn up, will basically turn up its value. And this value, this constant I naught, the exchange current density, it really is a function of the species that I have at both ends of my reaction, and really controlling the strength of that process as I'm trying to intercalate material or plate material in my system. This relationship is referred to as the Butler-Romer relationship, but we always also have other types of reactions that basically add up to this relationship. In this case, we have, for example, the Butler-Romer relationship, which, in addition to that, we should add any other side reactions that may occur, such as the SCI, dendrite formation. They all occur, and they're occurring in parallel. You can think of it as having additional intermediate wells to this double well that we just put in the system, and they would add directly to these reactions in the system. Okay, and these may impact directly the interfacial impedance, because this overpotential will be proportional to how large the drop of the interface is. And if that the thickness of that interface keeps growing, the overpotential may grow, but the rate at which mass transfers will also change. So you really want an interface there, but you don't want it to be too thick. Okay, other things that happen in a battery are, for example, you have salt precipitations, which basically as you take lithium out of the anode particles, and dump them into the electrolyte. The cathode particles are basically going to take that material, okay? But if you do it too fast, what's going to happen in the anode side, you can put too much lithium in it that will lead to salt precipitation. Well, and this one, what you have over here is really a two-dimensional model predicting that. And this is a 1D Newman-type model where as time progresses, lithium accumulates a lot on the backside of the anode, as you can see here, and on the back it will be completely depleted, suggesting with that if you dump too much lithium into the electrolyte phase, you can lead to the formation of, say, this additional crystallite system. And so really what you want is to have this balance of charge being exuded into the electrolyte with the amount of lithium that is being taken from the electrolyte into the particles. That unbalance will lead to a change in the charge ratio. So and if you have, in addition to that, this side reactions occurring, then you have to basically subtract the reversible contribution, which further unbalance the reactivity of the system. Now, clearly, because these interfacial reactions do matter, we care about the details of those reactions. And something we learned this week is that even though what we want is the lithium in solution to basically be intercalated lithium, sometimes we have that the anode, the material limitations or the material non-idealities of the electrode itself, especially in this case of the anode, leads to the solvent reduction, formation of non-desirable phases that can lead to the formation of SCI, okay, which if it forms and becomes stable, is actually favorable for use in a battery. But if this layer keeps growing and becoming thicker, at some point the performance of the cell will drop because it will be so thick that nothing will come through. As you can see, if the SCI layer is too small, we would have to make much more effort to actually put something in the particle, limiting with that also the performance. And if it's too thick, then nothing will happen. So we do care a lot of what happens and what the structure of this interface is. We talked about different descriptions, experimental descriptions of what happens in that interface. In this case, this set of measurements by Liu and Steve Harris on the content of lithium across a 15 nanometer SCI layer deposited on a copper substrate shows you that you have a region of the SCI that is dense. Okay, and in front of that you have a porous region through which lithium comes through, so that it comes very close to the substrate and basically reacts so that material can form or play through. We also learned that this SCI layer is not uniform. Okay, that actually as it forms, okay, even though ideally we want this the lithium metal to grow uniformly or to intercalate uniformly, instead we find that if in the case of a pure lithium electrode, that actually in some cases it bows, okay, because it prefers some regions with respect to other ones, and because the SCI layer happens to be mechanically stiff, okay, it can break, okay, leading to then inhomogeneities in lithium intercalation. And favoring, therefore, the formation of dendritic-like structures, which will lead again to the formation of inhomogeneities, and therefore leading to this basically kinetic instability that will form favor the formation of dendrites. Experimentally, that is observed through FEM, through the formation of these like micron-sized boulders under the SCI layer as the material forms, okay? And if instead of recharging your cell, you're trying to discharge it, you really want to remove lithium from the lithium metal through the SCI out, okay? And as that happens, if this inhomogeneity happens, some regions will plate faster than other ones, leading to these depressions on the system, which instead will lead to further breakage, okay? Could develop pinching, the formation of additional phases, and these inhomogeneities eventually will lead to lower efficiencies of the cell, and that can be experimentally observed as these giant depressions, micron-sized depressions in your substrate, which will indeed lead to poor performance because now these regions could be electrochemically isolated. In the anode, there's a whole set of aging mechanisms that are detrimental for the performance of the cell. Okay, and we find that from this whole list, all of them, all of these side reactions become basically detrimental, that in this case, for example, the decomposition of the electrode, the formation of ACI can be fixed by putting additives so that the ACI is stabilized. This is a good thing, okay? Because ACI continues to grow, that increases the impedance, and of course that can only be fixed by putting more stable ACI additives. And changes in porosity also lead to volume changes, and therefore ACI formation, contact loss of active material, which will also lead to capacity phase. And what people have done is also add additives. So basically, the game has focused on the addition of additives to stabilize the ACI so that we don't have to deal with a power or capacity fade as a result of the ACI or the side reactions coming out of hand, getting out of hand. Now, this of course on the anode side. In the cathode side, what you have is that the particles themselves can undergo internal structural disorder. You can, because of the electrochemical shocks that the particles are subjected to, you can have micro cracking in the particles. You can have a loss of contact, the formation of corrosive phases that will lead to poor contact with the back collector. And therefore, or the precipitation of additional phases that can migrate to the counter electrode or favor electrolyte decomposition and form gases that could lead to an unstable and unsafe battery. Okay, so you can see both cathode and anode, it not only consists on finding materials that you can match in particle size and thickness to have the optimal porosity, tortuosity, and energy density, but you also want to make sure that these material phases are compatible, so when you put them in the same system, the chemistry of one doesn't affect the chemistry of the other one, or the formation of the ACI doesn't impact the response. The ACI layer has many implications on the further stability of the system. And in the case of dendrite formation, what people have found is that dendrite can grow from the top as more material comes and accumulates, or it can come from the bottom, okay, as lithium basically is depositing. Okay, and in this case, these experiments suggest that that base growth dendrite really corresponds to the to some mechanism that is not well known, but it seems to be controlled by the local electrochemical interactions, and has been definitely proved to occur, because even if there is no material for it to attach on the surface, that dendrite will still be coming out. Okay, it's very much position dependent, because even though electrochemically a whole layer of material can be subjected to the same electrochemical conditions, the inhomogeneities occurring on the cell will effectively dictate what spots will become more electrochemically favorable, leading to the formation of spherical lithium beads, and as they nucleate, they will form and propagate towards the counter electrode, as shown by Harris and co-workers back in 2010. Okay, the theoretical description of these systems can be summarized in two large types of models, one by Chasavial and another one by Newman and Monroe, where they both of them propose that there is a critical overpotential, a critical driving force for its formation. They differ on the specific details. Okay, and then one of them proposes that there's a characteristic incubation time, while the other one really suggests that no such incubation time exists, that the moment you apply a large current, they just go. And in one case, they propose that the growth rate really is proportional to the applied electric field, and the other one is that they accelerate as they keep going. So in order to bring both descriptions into agreement, okay, a thermodynamic description suggests that if you account for the free energies of transformation and the surface contributions that are opposing its growth, you can account for an energy barrier that if you overcome it, you will be able to stabilize a nuclei of lithium for it to grow or shrink. If you do this, then you can control the size of the barrier and the characteristic size by applying an overpotential. So if you apply a negative overpotential, the size of the barrier will shrink, because you're basically pushing down this contribution. And if you apply a potential of the opposite polarity, you make the barrier higher. Okay? And if that happens, and you're able to overcome this barrier, then you can effectively form that. The characteristic sizes really depend effectively on the potential at the Gibbs free energy formation as well as the surface tension. Okay? So really suggesting that there is a critical size at which this happens. Also, there will be a critical potential in agreement with both Newman, Monroe, and Chasavial, and co-workers, that will happen as you admit the existence of an energy barrier that has to be overcome. Okay? And depending on what the size of the dendrite is and the conditions that that you're submitting that dendrite to, you could have that if the initial size of that dendrite is larger than a critical size, it'll grow until it reaches a terminal velocity, or it'll shrink if it's smaller than that characteristic size. Okay, in both cases, they agree with both the results of Chasavial as it reaches the terminal velocity, or Newman as it accelerates. Okay, and you can further discuss these additional details as you consider a finite domain as compared to an infinitely sized domain. If you can think of one specific dendrite that is, as it sees a large potential and it accelerates, the overpotential will increase, accelerating its velocity. So it's all within this framework. Okay, then we found that really we can summarize the different types of growth that these people have found into five regimes. One of them corresponds to the no growth regime, which is the regime at which you expect that dendrites are not thermodynamically stable, so they will not grow. One where if you apply a very large overpotential, the dendrites will spend a little time basically overcoming the barrier, very few time interacting with each other, and then basically taking off. A region where once you have made them thermodynamically stable, they spend a lot of time growing at the expense of the smaller ones so that they eventually reach the kinetic limit, and that corresponds to the long incubation time regime. And then once they have reached that the growth regime, their growth accelerates until they reach a terminal velocity in the case of having a voltage gradient very far away. Okay, and well, then the fifth regime corresponds to steady state growth. Okay, and you can use this as a map to identify those locations in which growth will happen. And clearly what you want is to avoid regimes that lead to the a small barrier for nucleation and small incubation times. And this is why when one charges your devices, you really are trying to be somewhere down here where they basically your current is large enough to intercalate or plate something, but not large enough to start nucleating heterogeneous nucleations. It's still a large field where we want to understand how dendrites are inhibited. It's still a long walk in order to get there, but really what you want is to develop low current density charging, okay, so that, and we want to increase the limit as to how low is low. We would like to make that larger. We want to develop intercalation compounds and polymeric solid electrolytes so that we can suppress the conditions in which dendrite will nucleate and also change the chemistry of the substrate so that this doesn't happen. This can also be done by coming up with better lithium anodes or alloyed anodes. And other people have tried things like applying pressure to the cell. This doesn't seem to be commercially viable. Electrolyte stirring. Okay? And well, to this point, we have talked about the individual mechanisms controlling the performance of the cell. We really haven't put all the pieces together. We haven't talked yet about the electrolyte. Okay? And that's what we're going to do in the fifth week of this course. Thank you.